Thank you. Thank you. Morning, church.
Morning.
You got to praise the Lord in you today?
Praise the Lord.
All right. Amen. Amen. No matter what's going on, we should have a praise for the Lord, shouldn't we? That's right. As Susie mentioned, I assume many of you are thinking, I saw on the front page of the paper this morning, we're all remembering 15 years ago. Memories flood back, thoughts, don't they? As I think about that time, one of the things I remember is that there was a lot of fear in a lot of people. You remember that? Did you know people showed fear? A lot of fear, it seemed like. A lot of people showed up in church that next Sunday and the Sunday after that, and then they started fading off again. Fear. I want to talk about fear today. Fear and love. Fear and love. Fear and love, did you know, cannot both control at the same time? Can't happen. Now I want to take you to 1 John today as we look at love and fear. 1 John in chapter 5, starting at verse 12, we get the purpose for this letter. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have life. And yet some people aren't sure whether they have God's Son or not. Next verse. I have written this to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may wonder if you have eternal life. No. It's written so that we might
know
that we have eternal life. So this letter is probably the letter in the book of the Bible to help people find out whether they're really saved or they're not saved. Whether they have the assurance. You get the truths out of this book and you can get the assurance that you belong to God, that you're gone to heaven, so that your fears will be taken away. Fears of dying, fears of wondering, that you may know what your standing is with God. There are those who are not teaching the truth. There are false teachers, false prophets in this world today, and they're talking about, as Susie was saying, all different ways to God. Many different ways. There's one way. But even those who have heard about the one way still wonder sometimes. People in the church still wonder, am I really saved? They may have prayed the prayer. They may have been baptized. They may have joined the church like I did. They may attend most every Sunday. They give money. They might even volunteer to serve in the church. Reminds me of a fellow I knew quite a few years ago in one of our churches. He was retirement age. Been in the church his whole life. Most of his church, he was in the Baptist church, but he'd grown up there, and his wife, because of his wife, they moved to our church. And he'd been active in the churches. And I still remember the night we were having a Bible study, and he was there, and we're talking about the assurance, knowing if you're saved or not saved. And what the topic that came up, of course, was faith. That we're saved by grace through faith. And there's nothing you can do to earn that salvation. God set it up so that it was by faith. And he scratched his head. He looked at me a couple of times. And he says, wait a minute. You're telling me that all my years of serving as a trustee And that work I just did in the bathroom here in the church, I remodeled the whole thing, put my own money into it. And here every Sunday, that doesn't do me a bit of good for getting to heaven. And his daughter happened to be in the Bible study, and she was glad old dad finally spoke up, because she'd been worried about his soul, and said, Dad, you can't do anything to earn your way into heaven. Nothing is by faith. God set it up so he could just give it to you if you'd believe what Jesus did for you. So God still has to confirm for many where they are with the Lord. If we're saved, we like hearing that we're saved over and over, don't we? Amen. But even in the church, there are those who are not, who are still wondering, who are still hoping they make it. So God put this letter in here. Verse 12. Oh, let's pray first. I'm sorry. Father. Oh, Father. Oh, Father. We need to know that we belong to you. We need to know that you love us. We need to know what that means and how that plays out in our lives, this love that you have for us. And Father, we want to know this morning what role fear might play in all of this. Speak to us, Lord. Reveal truth to us again. And Father, I admit I can't explain these scriptures today, these truths today. I just don't have the ability. It's going to take your revelation, the revelation of your Spirit to us. So please do that today, Lord. Reveal what you want us to hear about your love and about fear today. In Jesus' name, please give me the anointing to teach faithfully. And the church said, amen. Amen. Verse 12. 1 John 4. I'm going to back up to the previous chapter. Verse 12. No one has ever seen God. But if we love each other, God lives in us, and his love is brought to full expression in us. No one has ever seen God, but God can be seen in his children who love each other. His love can be seen in us the way we love each other. That's his point right here. He is defining right here, John is, what perfect love is, what complete love is. And he wants us to know in this letter and the place that love plays in this salvation of ours, he wants us to know that we can know that we're saved. That there is evidence that proves we are saved. We can know that by this evidence. One of the evidences that we are saved is that we love other believers. We love those in our church family. That is part of this perfect or completing love that he's talking about right here. We love each other. God loves me. Here's that completing love. This word completing right here, or brought to full expression in this translation, is talking about love starting with God. Him pouring it out to you. But love never stays in one place. Not God's love, does it? It's got to keep moving. So God's love flows through you to someone else. His love flows through you to someone else. And then that love, God's plan is for that love in that person then to return back to him as that person loves God. That's how God's love works. That's how it's perfect. It has a target. The target is it keeps moving through. through you to someone else and then back to God. Love turned back to God. Now, the word love here is not so much the feelings kind of love. This word refers to the love right here, an action love. What you do to show that you love other believers. In the verse 19, it speaks to this. We love each other because he first loved us. We are able to love. Why? Because he loved us first. We're able to love him, God, because he loved us first. You know, you don't have the capability to love God in yourself all by your lonesome. You don't have it. It's not in you. You weren't born that way. Sin nature ruined that. So if we're able to love God, it's because he put his love in us first. He loved us first. Complete love. Now, verse 13, let's move on here. And God has given us his Spirit as proof that we live in him and he lives in us. And we see he mentions here, God lives in us with his love and we live in God. It's a back and forth kind of thing. He's given us his Spirit. That's how he lives in us, by his Spirit. And his Spirit brings the love of God into us. God's love in us. And that love works in us and impresses God's image, the image of love inside you, so that you become a lover like God is. God putting his love in you by his Spirit so that you are now able to love. And that his Holy Spirit being in you is another assurance that God lives in you and that you are saved. His Holy Spirit comes into you, makes his home. Isn't that what it says in here? His Spirit lives in us. He makes his home in us. He brought his lazy boy with him. He set it up in your living room, in you. He lives in you. You getting the point here? Now, how can you tell if the Holy Spirit's at home in you, if he's dwelling there? Well, you can give him a call. That's how you tell if somebody's home or not, right? You call to their house. You give them a buzz. See if they're home. If they're home, then they answer, right? Isn't that the same way with the Holy Spirit? You pray to God, you give him a call, and when he answers, you know he's there, right? Haven't you done that many, many times with God? Haven't you taken many problems to God over the years? Isn't that right? You've given him a call. And hasn't he answered you many, many times over the years and proved that he was at home in you, that he abides in you? Another assurance that God lives in you. Thank you, Lord. Verse 14. Furthermore, we have seen with our own eyes and now testify that the Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. John was one of those who have a personal witness, actually saw Jesus when he was on this earth, along with the other apostles and many others. Personal witnesses that Jesus Christ is the Savior, that he came to save. And that salvation covers a bunch. Covers a lot of areas for us. Yep, we're saved from the wrath of God to come, aren't we? The Savior has done that for us, but he's also saved us from our selfishness and self-centeredness, hasn't he? He's also saved us from our pride. I'm so good at this. And he's also saved us from fear. All fears. Now that salvation, He's made available to the whole world. But the whole world's not saved, are they? Verse 15. All who confess or proclaim that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them, and they live in God. So who is saved? Well, here's another evidence of those whom God dwells in. They will proclaim Jesus. They'll proclaim that Jesus is God, that Jesus is the Savior, that Jesus is the only way, that Jesus can be trusted. Can you trust Jesus? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We proclaim that. We declare that. We declare Jesus unto others. Another evidence that God really dwells in us. Verse 16. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in His love. That phrase sounds like trust in His love. Sounds like that ought to be all through the Bible, but this is it. There's trust in all kinds of things about God, but here's the place where it mentions having trust in His love. Now, only people of faith can understand God's love. Since God is love, then whoever has love has God. And again, it's because of your faith in God that you knocked, that you called upon Him in times of trouble, and He answered and proved that He loved you. Amen. And proved that His love is in you. Verse 17. You can see why I can't explain this with words well. This has got to be a revelation of God. This is just, it just can't be explained with words. This love has to be known to get across. His Spirit working in us now, talking about it, revealing it to us in our hearts. 17. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment. Okay, now is his first mention of fear. His love in us keeps us from being afraid on the day of judgment. But we can face him with confidence because we live like Jesus here in this world. Another evidence that God lives in us is we live like him. God, the Holy Spirit, coming, bringing God's love. God's love dwells in us. God's love empowers us to live like God. God's love lives through us. So people watching us see what God's love is like. God in us. God in us, us in God. That's the mutual abiding in the way of love. And God's love being completed in us that way. In fact, we know He loves us because we love Him. And vice versa. It's a back and forth thing. God's love never sits still. And only you and I can stop that process. God loving us and us loving Him back. Loving somebody else and that love getting back to God. Only we can stop that process. God's always loving. When we love Him, then we trust His love. Okay, I'm going to get more to the nitty gritty here. When we love Him, we trust His love. We trust His care for us. No matter what the trouble is that we're confronting, no matter how deep and dark, no matter how much the devil tries to scare us with the trouble, if we trust His love, it means we're trusting His care in the middle of that trouble, no matter what it is. Because He said, all things work together for good. No matter how difficult it is, God somewhere, some way, because He loves me and because He's God, will work that trouble for my good. Do you believe it, church?
Amen.
When you know Jesus, if you know Jesus, you will love Jesus because you know He loved you. He's more than just your Savior, isn't He, church? He's your friend, isn't He? He's with you in the midst of all of those things that come at you and yours. So when Jesus returns, when He comes back in the clouds, and then when He comes back at the second coming on the earth, when He returns to judge sin, yep, most of the people on this earth are going to be overcome with fear. That's going to be scary for them. They don't want to see Him. In fact, I found out that there's a lot of people in the church are a bit afraid of Jesus coming back, of His return. They're not ready. And yet, you and I aren't going to be afraid. We don't fear His coming. In fact, we're going to be happy about it. It's the great hope. Wonderful joy comes to our minds just thinking about Jesus coming back. Our friend. Our God who loves us. Who died for us. He's family. Isn't He? Family's coming to see us. Coming to get us. Hallelujah. It's like that little toddler. About this tall. You know, Grandma's been spoiling that little toddler. And so anytime Grandma comes to the house, that toddler knows Grandma loves it. And so that toddler's looking forward to Grandma coming through the door. Well, that's the same with us and Jesus. When we see Him coming, we know He loves us. He's shown it. He's proved it. His love's in us. Oh, boy, here He comes. Yeah, we're looking forward to that. We won't be afraid. There's another assurance to us having God in us. We won't be afraid when He returns. We're looking forward to it. Should we be afraid of a friend coming to see us? Should we be afraid of Jesus? Of course not. Now I want to take that principle and apply it to people. Should we be afraid when people come to see us? Uh-oh, now we're taking off here in a little different direction. Do you look forward to your friend coming to visit you? When you see him pull up or knock at the door? Does that give you joy? Do you love their coming when they stop by to see you? See, if we are not looking forward to someone, then could fear be a part of that? Could we fear maybe what they want to do when they visit with us or come to see us? I remember quite a few years ago, one couple in one of our churches had a wedding anniversary date the same as ours, Becky and I. When they found that out, they called us up and said, hey, as our anniversary rolled around, let's go celebrate together since we have our anniversary is on the same day. And so we did. We went out and had a good time with them. And then they started talking at the table. They said, we ought to do this every year. And Beck and I looking at each other and wondering, well, I don't know about every year. You know, we're enjoying it this time around, but every year? Well, could that be a little bit of fear came into me? I'm afraid of them wanting to do this every year when maybe I don't really want to every year. And even with our friends, sometimes maybe we get a little afraid of what they might say about us to others because they know things about us that others don't know because they're friends and close to us. Or you ever fear maybe somebody wants to get too close to you? Huh? Maybe you don't want to be that close as they'd like to be to you. And when you get that attitude, could that stop you or hinder you in any way from being friendly toward them, from treating them as Jesus would have you treat them, from keeping you from agape, loving them? Even when we are unfriendly with friends, fear is involved. I'm going to take the question mark out of it, and I'm just going to make it a statement. Fear is involved. Afraid that we won't get our work done. We won't get our rest needed. I had someone stop at the house not long ago, and it was on my day off, and I had a schedule for the day. I wanted to accomplish this and that, and they stopped in unannounced, brought someone with them, and I thought, gee, I'm not going to get my stuff done today. And I hope I didn't convey that, but I was battling that. Or you visit, somebody visits you, and it just seems like they're never going to go home. Yeah. And you're thinking, I need to get to bed. I got to get up early in the morning. I'm afraid they're hanging around too long. I'm afraid they showed up at the wrong day. Love doesn't care. Our oldest son, Bracken, and his wife, Kimberly, it doesn't matter when you stop in there unannounced, what they're doing. It's come on in. They're going to feed you, and they're going to sit down and enjoy you. And you'll enjoy them. They don't care. Because they love you. And they have God's love in them. So they're able to love without being afraid of this or that or the other thing. Now, if the fear were removed, would we be free to treat them as God wants us to treat them? And if there are those that you feel a little unfriendly toward, I want to tell you, you have a fear of them. You might not recognize it as fear, but there is fear there. Now, someone might be thinking, when they see someone like that, oh, I just don't know what it is about them. It's just something about them. I couldn't really say what it is. That might be fear of the unknown. You're not sure why they make you feel uncomfortable. The fear might be indirect. You might be afraid of what others will think if you get too close to these so-and-so people here. They see that you're friendly with them. Love drives fear away. Amen. Like light drives darkness away. Now, these truths give us two principles about relationships. These truths that we've just been sharing about love and fear. If there are people who have continual relationship problems, then that's probably revealing some fears that they have. And that person might be thinking to themselves, no, it's the other person. It's the other person with the problem. They're just reacting to God in me. You ever heard that before? You'll hear it again. Are you sure? Are you sure they're reacting to God in you? You don't have a fear you need to deal with right there? Do you harbor any negative thoughts about them at all? Are you complaining in your mind about them in any way? then that is revealing fear. Another principle we get about relationships there. Obvious fears, fears that people do acknowledge that they have, reveal relationship problems. Any fears reveal relationship problems. Are you afraid, for example, of not having a mate? Are you afraid of not having children? Are you afraid of not having a pension? Are you afraid of the water system breaking down and you're not having water coming into your house? Are you afraid of not having air conditioning in the hot weather? Or are you afraid of losing what you have? Do you have fears of being alone? Do you have a fear of being in a nursing home with no one coming to see you? Do you have fears of others not liking you? Do you have fears of loved ones forsaking you? I know of a lady that when she was a little girl, she built up she was old enough to have a real good, strong relationship with her dad. And her dad died. Now later on in life, she got married. And some fears returned to her. And she didn't know what was causing these fears, but down deep, part of that was a fear of losing her husband like she'd lost her dad. And so she started checking the doors on her house every night before going to bed. And she'd check all the windows to make sure that every single window go around the house. It became a routine. And then she picked up this routine every time she left the house. She didn't want anyone breaking in, we found out later on, and harming her husband, or being there waiting when they get home to harm her husband. And then she added to the routine. She had to go around and unplug everything electrical that didn't have to be plugged in. She's afraid that it might get a fire, and she'd lose him to fire. Then she started washing her hands before bedtime and before leaving the house. And then she's washing her hands 7 times every time. Found out later that's because she was afraid of giving him germs and then him dying. Fears. Are you afraid of loved ones leaving you? Are you afraid of personal disasters? A financial disaster? Are you afraid of that happening in the world or the United States? Are you afraid of fire coming into your home? Are you afraid of a tornado when you hear they're coming by? Are you afraid of cancer? The C word when you hear it? Are you afraid that maybe you won't be able to handle things when they come at you? Are you afraid of dogs? Are you afraid of snakes? Are you afraid of wasps? Are you afraid of darkness? I know a few people who are afraid of bridges, long expanse bridges, just will not go over them. I know some others are afraid to go into Walmart because it's too big a room, and they're afraid the ceiling's going to come down on them. Will not go into those big buildings with big rooms like that. Are you afraid? Do you have fears like that? Are you afraid of death? I have a pastor friend, and he's not afraid of seeing Jesus at all. He says, I'm looking forward to going to heaven, Jesus, but what if I die? He says, I'll admit, I have a fear of those dying moments what the pain's going to be like, what I might have to go through at the time of my death. I have a fear there. Are you afraid of death? You afraid of God not being there? Sometime when you're facing a trouble, you afraid He won't show up? The more you have God, the more you have His love, and the less fear can control you. Fear reveals ultimate relationship problems with God. With God. Fear shows that we're not trusting God. You hear me, church? Fear is saying, God may not take care of me in this one or mine, but He said He would, church. Didn't He? Didn't He say, I'll never leave nor forsake you? You can believe what He says. Amen? See, that's the difference between a believer and an unbeliever. The believer believes that God will never leave nor forsake, no matter how deep nor dark the trouble is. Verse 18. Listen, look at this. Now that leads us into this verse. Such love, the love of God, has no fear, because perfect love expels most fears. Perfect love expels all fears. Darkness, dogs, snakes, not having, losing to, the C word, all fears. Verse 18, we continue on. If we are afraid, it's for fear of punishment. You know, thinking that, well, God's mad at me for what I did wrong, and so He's probably not going to show up to help me here or to help mine because of their sins. And this shows that we have not fully experienced His perfect love. See, where there is fear or dread, there's the thought of punishment, which comes from guilt, which comes from sin. Not trusting God's love is sin. But faith, that's what God wants to see. Faith, which is trusting His love and obeying. That's obeying is the part that shows you're truly trusting. But faith allows us to trust His love for us, and therefore His care for us, no matter how deep and dark the trouble might be. Verses 19 and 20. And He moves it back to this relationship. If we truly have love, God's love, we love each other because He first loved us. He placed His love in us so that we will love one another. If someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister, that person's a liar. For if we don't love people who we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? See, love to God is shown by love to men. Even the unsaved. Does God love the unsaved people out there? Now, so if God's love is in you, then that love, His love in you, will love the unsaved out there because He loves them. Amen? So you care about them. You know, even if they got long hair and ponytails way down to here and cuss like who knows what, God still loves them, doesn't He? And therefore, you will love them because his love is driving you, moving you, living through you. And if you love the unsaved, if he loves the unsaved that much, how much does he love the brothers and sisters, the brethren in the church? Deeply. If you love God, you're going to love your brother because God's in him. Amen? So you're loving God in him when you're loving them. So we will, and that'll be proof that there's a God. No one can see him, but there he is. In that love that we have, especially for the brethren. You see, so that's why one reason we get together. We got to get together. Sunday morning just don't get it. Not if we love each other. It don't get it. That's not how love acts. Love's got to do. It's got to do. It's action. We've got to hang out. And if this love is lacking, God's saying, for the brethren, he says, then you don't have love for me. And that's the truth. But if you do have love for the brethren, you have love for the lost, now that's proof I live in you. You have the assurance that you're saved, that you're mine. That love is lacking, then fear is working. Fear is at work. Okay, I want you to answer me out loud. All right, I'm going to ask you a few questions. Do you want to love God? Do you want to love the lost? Do you want to love the brethren? Do you want to be free of all fears? Then trust God's love and obey his word. That's what trusting his love is. Obeying his word. Now, as we close in prayer, some of you have been carrying some awful fears for a long time. And these fears have been plugging things up in relationships. It stops love. That love of God in us. God wants to set you free of whatever the fear might be. So as we close, I want to invite you to bring that fear, whatever it might be. For some of you, it's on your mind right now. To bring that fear forward and to bring it to God and lay it to God right here. Give it to him. And let's trust him to give us victory over it. So it doesn't hound you and doesn't keep you from loving others and from loving God. Amen? Father, we come in Jesus' name. And you can come forward right now as I'm praying. I encourage you to bring that fear up here, unless you want to haul it around some more. Father, we thank you for this great love that you have for us. A great love. What more could you do to prove that you love us, Father God? And yet, we still run into troubles and question whether you're going to take care of us in the midst of it. Forgive us, Lord God. Forgive us, Lord God. And we turn to you for mercy. We don't deserve your love. We don't deserve the freedom from fears. We don't deserve that, but we count on your mercy. You told us to trust your mercy, Father God. It's because of your love that you help us. You're faithful. You'll be there this time and the next time. Thank you, Father. So, Lord, be merciful unto us today, especially those who've come forward today and shown their trust in you and in your love. Give freedom, Lord, from fear in whatever form it might be. Give freedom and replace that fear with your love.
Amen.
Your abiding love. And we thank you. We thank you. Your continuing good work in us. You're continuing to perfect this love, your love, in us. Thank you. And we love you, Lord God. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' wonderful name. And we'll just continue in prayer right into the prayer tablet this morning. We have a prayer request for a brother, Brother Ed, who's had a serious infection, a blockage in arteries, urological bad news, PSA elevations, and they're praying, asking that there isn't any prostate cancer. First of all, Father, we pray for peace in the midst of this. The peace of knowing your love and your care, no matter this trouble nor any other. Please give them courage and strength. And let them know your love and your presence with them. And allow it to drive out all fears. And give them victory over any trouble here, Lord, that they're facing. Also have a prayer request for a sister-in-law's elderly father, Don, who collapsed after a round of golf and is in ICU. Lord, they're praying that there's nothing serious that's going to continue to hinder him in his life. No serious health problems. And that whatever, if there is, that you just heal it and fix it now. And again, we pray for your love to be known by him. And we have a praise for baby Abriel that we've been praying for. She has that was born at 24 weeks. She's gained 2 ounces and is stable. And we give you the credit, Lord God, and we give you the thanks for answering our prayers and showing your love again. Thank you, Lord. But continue to bring that baby along. And we thank you for Esther, Lord, and for you helping her and bringing her home. And we just know, and we continue to ask, that you'll continue that good work in her. Thank you, Lord. And we pray for Tom and his follow-up doctor's appointments and all that's confronting him. And now, Father, we ask that you'd hear our prayers. Whatever burdens you may have, or the burdens of others, would you just whisper them to God in prayer right now? In the loving name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And the believers said, amen. 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 You can always stay at the altar long as you want. After the service, you can come forward. We want to use this altar. Amen. It's a symbol, if you will, of coming to God and trusting God.
Amen.
All rise, please. Church, you're filled with God's love. Share it this week, will you? Boy, there's some people out there need to know love. They need loved. Love them. He's going to run you into some of them. Amen.